Good morning, everybody. This is a pleasant occasion and happiest occasion. And this is the webinar session on behalf of Cheran Institute of Health Sciences and Cheran College of Physiotherapy. Okay, we are going to have a webinar session on ethics and clinical research and clinical practice by Dr. Mudashir Rashid Baba. And he's a MPT, PhD. Okay, she did finish her ethics specialized course in the specialized university, and she is working as an associate professor in Enopova University, Mangalore. Okay, she is a well-known person and she is more interested in research, and she published so many articles, research papers, publications, and she had so many citations, and she had patent rights, everything. She's a well-known person and he's a knowledgeable person in research. Once again, of Cheran Sciences and Cheran College of Physiotherapy. Once again, I welcome you for a webinar session. Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Madam Jensi. I would like to thank Cheran College of Physiotherapy for giving me this opportunity to present. I request participants to mute their mics. It's a request to participants, kindly mute your mics. Am I audible?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes. Fine. Thank you so much, Madam Jensi, for giving a very beautiful introduction of mine. I would like to thank Professor Selvarani and Professor Jensi, because I have been their student and it's my privilege to be here to take this platform. Thank you once again to all of you. And I have a very good morning greetings to all of you over here. Some of may be students, some of may be faculty. And today I'm going to take to a different field and a different subject, which is very interesting, in fact. And being a researcher and being a clinician, we should all know what ethics is all about. So I'll be sharing my slides. Kindly let me know whether you are able to see my slides. Is my slides visible?
Yes, ma'am.
All right. Thank you so much. Yeah, I'll take them into the slide more. Fine. I submit again the delighted greetings from Yenapoya Dean to B University. Before I go ahead, I'll just give a brief introduction about myself. I'm Dr. Mudassir. I have done PhD in idiopathic scoliosis from Yenapoya Dean to B University. I have done my MPT in pediatrics, and I have a specialized training in bioethics in collaboration with Yenapoya University and Gothenburg University, Germany. And I currently work as an associate professor in the field of physical therapy department. And I am a well-known faculty for Center of Ethics, where I teach ethics approach and ethics subject to all the fraternity, our MBBS students, BDS students, and other fraternity students. And today's topic is about ethical challenges in research and clinical or healthcare practice. As we all know that now we are in that era that where we practice on evidence-based. Wherever we go, we should have an evidence-based practice, no matter we are a researcher, no matter we are a clinician. So once, for example, we are submitting a research project to an ethics committee, or we are publishing an article, we face lots of challenges in our research. What exactly are the questions which are put up for us? We ourselves are not aware. We don't know how we are approaching the research participants, how we are collecting the data, how we are doing the research, whether we are doing ethically or unethically. Same way, if you're going for a clinical practice, no matter if it is a physician or it is a physical therapist or it is a dentist or any kind of healthcare worker. So what we do is we just go for a practice, but we don't know whether we are following ethical norms in our practice, which may cause harm to us as well as harm to the patient. So it is a very interesting subject which has come up in India. And I will just share you a story how this ethics has come into existence, how we are following it in our slides. Okay, so coming first to the research, exactly what research is all about. So nowadays, if we have done our MPTs, now then later on, we want to go for research, PhD, then later on, we want to go for postdocs, and we have several researches in on top of our head, on our shoulder, where we want to prove our research, best research, and we want to go for higher qualification, we want to go for higher position and all those things. But how our research is considered as a good research, how our research is considered as ethical good research, because nowadays when we go for a publication also, the publication anywhere, wherever it is in your department or you are trying any other university or anywhere across the country, they ask you, what is the index? What is the indexing of your publication? What is your H index? What is your Google Scholar? What is your Orsted ID? All those questions, you know, which goes out of our mind. We say like we have not done anything accordingly what we are going to do in future, right? So we do research. Certain, we have seen like many organizations are there where they conduct research, but there is no ethical approval. So once we do the research, we do hard work, we send it for the publication, and the high index journals ask us, where is your ethical approval? But unfortunately, we don't have any. So we lose our credentiality of our research or our work, what we have done. So I'm not going to take deep about research, what research is. So all we know what research is, it is something like we are identifying the answer to our question. So day-to-day life, if we get any question, we try to find out the solution of that question, the answer of that question. So how we are following the method, how we are following the protocol, that is called as methodology. So we take, if time permits, I can take that and another topic as how the research about research. Now I'm talking only about the ethical approaches. So I'm just giving you a brief about research. So coming to the ethical considerations or ethical challenges, what we face now as a researcher or as a clinical practitioner, but those issues have been already come into the existence during the Second World War. I'm not sure whether all of you know or any one of you know about the Second World War. And during that Second World War, many researches and many experiments were conducted by various doctors and various scientists. So those scientists and those doctors are currently known as doctors from hell. Why they are called as doctors from hell? Because during the Second World War, the Nazi experiment was conducted on humans. You must be asking me, what is Nazi? Nazis were the people, those who were belonging from German, those were German people. So they were prisoners and all the doctors were taken research on them and they did the experiments on them. And these horrific and brutal, all these unethical researches were happening between 1939 and 1945. So at least 70 medical research projects were involved, were taken care of during that period, and which gave a very cruel and lethal experimentation on the human subjects. And all these human subjects were none other than the Nazis. Those were the prisoners of Germany. So if you could see the picture, is my slides visible?
Yes, ma'am.
Fine. Yeah, fine. Thank you. So if you see the picture over here, you could see that there were all males, females, boys, girls, and you know, all children were taken into a camp, which is called as Nazi concentration camp. So those prisoners were vulnerable population. So vulnerable population is something which we could say in ethical terminology, like they have no rights to defend. For example, they were prisoners, they were in jail, and they were taken without their permission, they were taken for the experiments. And these experiments were very horrific experiments, and 20 physicians were involved in this research. So what kind of researches were done? So if you just think, if you see the picture on my right side of the slide, you could see these are the real faces, original pics, what I have extracted from Google. These were the doctors and the scientists, those who were conducting the human experiments. Certain experiments were conducted where the participants All those prisoners, they were put on high altitude temperature and they were given no oxygen. They were put in the chambers of around 68,000 feet height. And finally, they want to see what will be the effect on them. But these population were vulnerable. They had no rights to defend against their rights. There was no dignity given to them. So certain experiments were also done, like removal of section of bones, muscles, nerves, and sometimes the whole leg was removed without anesthesia. Can you just imagine a person sitting on a table, dissection table, and removing muscles without giving him any anesthesia, without giving him any kind of dignity or concern? They were just wounded and just trying. What was the research? They were trying the effect of sulfonamide antibiotics. So these were certain, very brutal researches what were conducted on Nazis. So I'm just taking you because you should not, it's a new subject. You should not, it should be quite understandable to you. That's what I have taken you the history. So if you see the voices of the victims, if you could see the pictures here, the first picture, if you see a lady was put in a very icy water and she was, put there for hours and hours together to see the effect. So that was one of the study. The second picture, if you see, he was a Romani gypsy victim and he was taken to a seawater to see the effect. The seawater was, inserted in him through intramuscular injections or IVs, and this poor fellow had no rights to say no. And if you see the third side, you can see that there were, genetic studies were conducted. Twins were there. Females were there, fertility studies were conducted, where all these vulnerable population had no rights to say no. And if you could see the other one picture over here the patient participant was given a traction. So traction was put in such a way and it was pulled to a high altitude to see about the fractures the person will get. Just imagine how torture and ill-treated researches were done. So if they were twins, so some genetic studies were conducted in order to see the genetic similarities. So these studies were going on for till 1946. So later on, when 1946, October 25, there came a Nuremberg proceedings. It was done by American Nuremberg Military Tribunal. So if you could see the picture, these are all those 20 physicians and scientists, those who have done a brutal research in Nazi experiments. So these were prosecuted. They were called by the American Nuremberg Military Tribunal and they were put on jail. And then they established some kind of principles, like which we called as 10 principles of ethical conduct in medical research, which came in existence in 1949. So they said, if any medical research is conducted anywhere across globe, we should follow 10 basic principles. Okay. So that basic principles, we called it as Nuremberg Code. Okay. So this Nuremberg Code, it started from 1939 to 1945. So they said any kind of human experiment, there should be a Nuremberg Code set to set the ethics, to set the research protocol for a proper research. But later on, what happened is the Nuremberg Code, which they gave the principles, I'm just talking over here only about FAIR principles, that is the voluntary consent of the human subject. What you say about voluntary consent? Voluntary consent is something when a person is requested to participate for a study, we should have a proper consent form that I will take in the next slides, what exactly it comprises of. So the voluntary consent from a participant should be there. The experiment should be done in such a way that it should have a good result for the society and the results should justify the performance of experience. So how many of you agree with me? Like we have many students like UGs, PGs, and some researches are going on where we are just doing the research for our academic sake or to fulfill our degrees, but we are not seeing the good of it. We are not seeing whether this research is benefited for society, whether this experiment will justify our results, whether we will be able to prove anything based on this research. So the experiment—
Hi, ma'am. Can you hear me?
Yeah, I can hear you.
Just I want to confirm whether the slides are changing because I'm having the only the first slide.
Oh, you're having first slide. That's what maybe. I told. Somebody told me like which slide you are having right now. First one.
The first one. Do yeah. Now it's been changed. Numbering Nuremberg code. Yeah.
Yes.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you.
Okay. So I think I'll put in this mode only. Otherwise, I'm just. Is it okay? Like if I put in this mode, not the slide share mode.
And now I can view the slide. Oh, thank you.
Okay. All right. So the experiment should be conducted in order to avoid all unnecessary physical and mental suffering. So whenever we do any kind of research, for example, like if we have any faculties over here in this platform, we give research to our students, no matter it's a PhD, MPT, or BPT, if you have any undergraduate projects in your institution. So we give them studies and we tell them, okay, fine, conduct this, do that. But we will not ethically train them. What exactly a person, a researcher or an investigator is supposed to do in order to avoid all kind of unnecessary physical and mental suffering to any participant. So you might be saying like we belong to a physical therapy and when we give any kind of protocol, for example, if we go for an exercise protocol, it is not going to harm any patient, right? You can interrupt me in between if you have any questions. I'll be happy to have discussion as well in between. So it is something like we'll say, oh no, I'm just giving an exercise protocol to my participant. I don't think so. It's going to harm him or her. No, it is. Because if you are giving a simple questionnaire to any participant to fill, that also causes mental suffering. That also causes mental harm to the patient, which we have to take care during our research. So the degree of risk should be never exceed that the determination of importance of the patient or the experiment which we are solving. So whenever we are taking any kind of research, for example, we give a research topic to our students, they come and see. So I always take that first we have to, I tell my students, first tell me what is the sample. I'm not going for a topic. I just want to know what is your population, whom you are taking. Fine. Okay, once you are done with the population, second thing is whether you will get an enough sample size. Yes. Okay, whether there is any harm. Yes. So all these points are very important whenever we take any kind of research. So this Nuremberg Code, they said all these points and they said that the experiment should be conducted in a very scientifically qualified person. If you see that nowadays, many researches have been conducted, like we just give sample. And suppose, for example, we have many kinds of what we call as adjuvant therapies, like we have cupping therapy, we have dry needling, we have taping. But these are the extra courses what our students, our faculties are taking. But do we have expertise in that to take a research? It is not like one have conducted workshop on some kind of cupping therapy and 2 days workshop, he or she is certified, he gets a certificate and he can take the research on that. No, which is going to be a very harmful for the patients, which is really unethical. A person can be behind bars if any ethical committee or ethics comes into their existence. So these are certain points which we have to see that whether our experiment is conducted by scientifically qualified person. Okay, so next thing is we should have the experiment on human subjects and we should give them the liberty that if there is any physical harm or if there is any mental harm, they can discontinue with the study wherever it is possible. So these are certain points which were given by the Nuremberg, but still the researches were going on. Nuremberg came, code came, and they gave some kind of 10 principles stating that there shouldn't be brutal researches and all that after Nazis have taken the research. But still, the people did not stop. Researchers did not stop. They started continuing with the research in very brutal and unethical way. So how many of you have heard about this lady, Henrietta Lacks? Have you heard about her? Are you there with me?
No, ma'am. We didn't.
Oh, you have not heard about it. Okay, thank you for your response. Have you heard about a polio vaccine?
Yeah.
Yes. you know polio vaccine. But do you know from where polio vaccine has come?
Oh, ma'am.
No.
Savannah.
Sorry? Okay. So you don't know about Henrietta Lacks, who was Henrietta Lacks, but you have heard about polio vaccine. But have you just tried to find out how polio vaccine has come? Being a researcher, being a clinical practitioner? No, we don't, right? We don't. Okay, polio vaccine is there. It has come. Polio vaccination is given to the patient. If the patient comes to us with a polio, we start with our own protocol. We start giving the passive range of motions. We start giving the stretching exercises. We start give other kind of protocols. But do we think as a healthcare professional, as a medical professional, do we think like how it has come? Being a researcher, do we think? No, we don't actually. So I will just share a story about this. Henrietta Lacks, she was a black tobacco farmer from Southern Virginia. And she got cervical cancer when she was 30 years of age. Okay, in 1951, she was a young mother, had 5 children, and she visited John Hopkins Hospital, USA, and where she complained of vaginal bleeding. So when she was approached there and she was gone for examination by a renowned gynecologist called Dr. Howard Jones, and what on examination, he found that she has a malignant tumor on her cervix. So at that time, John Hopkins Hospital was only one hospital which was giving treatment to these poor Africans. She was an African lady. So finally, when she was detected and diagnosed with carcinoma in cervix, she was referred to a lab where Dr. George Kay was there. And what Dr. George Kay did is like he snipped her cells from the uterus without telling her. Do you think it's right?
No.
No, that's wrong, right? So what he discovered that, so Dr. Kay, he was a researcher, he was a pathologist, microbiologist. So he wanted to do some research. So he put this lady in dark. He did not tell her anything about the cells and he snipped the cervix cells from her. Then he started doing research on that. When he did research on that, he just saw that fortunately, Henrietta Lacks cells were not dying. They were growing infinitely. Indefinitely, they were growing. And he was very happy to perform various researches on her cells. So for years, a prominent cancer and virus researchers, they collected the cells from all the patients who come to John Hopkins Hospital with cervical cancer, but simply the cells were dying. But this was only one lady's cells, that is Mrs. Henrietta Lacks cell, which had some kind of unique power and it were doubling like every 20 to 24 hours. And it was a very good news to the researchers. Are my slides visible?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, fine. Thank you. So there was no exactly knowing how many Henrietta cells are alive today. So many scientists, if you just see that, they have calculated around 350 million feet cells were spanning and they were keep on doing research on her cells and they were generating money on her. It has been millions and billions of dollars where John Hopkins Hospital has, extracted from Henrietta Lacks cells. But Henrietta Lacks was not aware of that. And she died with cancer. She died in 1951. So the tumor killed her, but they did not kill her. We can't blame these doctors or scientists like they killed her. No, it was a tumor who killed her. But what happened with her cells was completely taken unethical way. She was not given any kind of dignity. She was not given, she has not given any kind of consent, and she don't know how much money these people have generated from her. And if you see that now, the vaccine which has come, or the polio vaccine, or certain drugs which are treating herpes, leukemia, influenza, hemophilia, and Parkinson's disease, those all drugs have come generated from Henrietta Lacks cells. So, but later on, what happened? This, if you see the picture over here, Dr. George Kay, and you could see Mrs. Henrietta Lacks, And down, if you see a group of people, these are Henrietta Lacks family. They were poor. They had no money to pay for their medical insurance. So they were suffering because they were Black Africans living in USA. So finally, somebody came to know about Henrietta Lacks, like cells have been generated and the researchers are taking advantages of her, and they have commercialized her cells in billions of dollars, and they are having a very much good profit in the medical research about this. So anyhow, somebody informed them, and then what they did is that they put a case against the Johns Hopkins Hospital, and they were requesting for the reimbursement. Here I'm just telling you the stories of all these so you understand that finally I may ask you certain questions like how you can relate the ethical issues. So this was the second study done on after Nuremberg Code came, but still people did not stop. They started doing the research in unethical way. Then followed by another research, which is called as Tuskegee Syphilis Experiment. Have you heard about it?
No, ma'am.
Okay. So Tuskegee was a study which was conducted on syphilis patients. Again, it was a clinical study, and it was conducted in Negro males. And this study was conducted between 1932 to 1972. Okay. So it was around 40 years of study was conducted on these Black Negroes. And actually, Tuskegee University, it is in Alabama, that is in USA. So from United States of Public Health, people came to Tuskegee University and they approached doctor and one nurse there. I will show you a picture of that. And they told them, we will take a research on Negroes people. So about them, the research, what was the research conducted? They said that we have come from Centers of Disease Control and Prevention. Here, what they told these Black Negro people, that will be extracting a bad blood from you, whatever is your bad blood in your body, we will extract that blood from your body. And this study will take around 6 months and you will be benefited out of this. You will get the free medication and all those things. These were vulnerable population. These were Black Negroes, and they were told wrong, actually, what we are going to do to them. Actually, the study was on syphilis. They want to see the effect of syphilis disease on these patients, but it was not told to these participants. But this study, as it was told, like it will take 6 months, but it took around 40 years. Okay. So here there were the major ethical violations, ethical standards, ethical issues happened. So when they were extracting the blood from these Negroes, they extracted blood and they did the research and they found the injection, which was valid for penicillin. Okay, but still this injection was not given to these participants because they wanted to see the syphilis patient, how they are getting the crippling deformities, how they are getting disabled, and they want to prove that in research. And it was really, again, a very bad research what happened for 40 years. Just imagine, if you see a picture, these were the two doctors for those who were working in, sorry, doctor and nurse, those who were working in Alabama University. And if you get time, so I have just quoted over here, there's a movie on this, Miss Evers Boys. If you see this movie, Miss Evers Boys, it is freely available in YouTube. You will just see the full history, what happened in Tuskegee syphilis study. It was 40 years, how they conducted and all. I have just taken a brief, okay? So after all these researches, when these Tuskegee syphilis also did a 40 years of research that was in very brutal and very cruel way, then came another report called as Belmont Report. How many of you know what is Belmont Report? Any PhDs here, PhD scholars? Any PhD scholars here? Please feel free, it's a discussion. If you don't know, you can tell me no, please.
We don't know about.
Okay, but you are a PhD scholar, right?
No.
No, you are not. Okay, fine. So Belmont Report. So whenever we submit any kind of research, no matter it's a UG or it's a PG or it's any kind of our faculty project or it's our PhD project, so we should always consider Belmont report, which is very, very important for overall taking research. So when we are adhering the rules of Belmont report, our study is good, our research is good, we have not crossed any ethical challenges, we will not harm paid participants, and we will get the published in very good journals, high index journals, if we are following the Belmont report. So Belmont report, it was first written by the National Commission for the Protection of Human Subjects of Biomedical and Behavioral Research. And it was prompted, how it was prompted? After the Tuskegee syphilis study came. So what exactly is the Belmont report? Belmont report is something like a human values which are based on set of medical ethics. So we have four principles. Nuremberg Code gave us 10 principles, but Belmont gave us four principles. The first one is called as autonomy. Autonomy is self-determination, dignity of a participant or a patient. I'm talking in both ways, clinical practice and the research. So autonomy, when we talk about autonomy, the respect of a participant, dignity of a participant, which is very, very important. No matter a patient comes to your clinic or a research, as a researcher, you are taking any participant. So informed consent, that is the consent which a participant or a patient gives us for the treatment. The second one is beneficence. Beneficence means support, we are giving any kind of benefit to the participant or to the patient. How many of us do that when we have a clinical practice? We get a patient, we tell them, okay, each modality we are charging you $100. So you have an os, for example, I'm just giving an example. If the patient is having osteoarthritis knee, so we tell them, okay, fine, you're coming to my clinic, I'll be giving you four modalities. Each modality will cost you 100 rupees. So daily you have to pay me 400 rupees. How many of you do that? Or how many of us have already done that? Many of us, right? It's not only physiotherapy I'm talking about. I just give you an example because we have a platform of about physical therapy. So that's what I asked Madam Jensi, you please tell me who all are attending. So I give examples based on the participants who all are there. So what exactly happens? We have done that. Many of us have done that. And many of us are doing it right now, but which is very, very wrong. We see our benefit. We don't see the patient's benefit. Okay, so non-maleficence, that is injustice or any harm. For example, if a patient comes to us, we have told that we want to give you four modalities for your osteoarthritis knee, but we are very sure enough that only one modality can help her out to reduce swelling. It is no need to go for four modalities to charge her for 400 rupees. Okay, so for example, if you're just having some kind of equipment which gives a very harm to the patient, but we just want to get some money, we tell, okay, fine, you do it. We don't see the risk benefit ratio, which is very important for clinical practice as well as in research also. Nowadays, I don't know about Tamil Nadu side, I mean Coimbatore side, whether they have started, but we do that. As I'm the faculty for Center of Ethics, I'm the ethics committee member also, we go for visits. We go to visit to clinics, whether any unethical issues are happening, any researches are happening, we go for the spot inspection to see whether how the data has been collected, how they are keeping the confidentiality. We do that. Now, ethics is very strong, which we have to take care of. Because now I took ethics in the physiotherapy, I want to spread it because I want my fraternity to know what exactly is ethics. So we follow the medical guidelines like other medical professionals are following. The fourth one is justice. How justice, whether we are giving justice to the patients, whether we are giving the treatment, best treatment to the patient, and we live in very old era stating that, okay, fine. So this patient has come, we will go for some mobilization exercises, we go for some wax therapy, so the patient will be all right. But we don't go to research, back to research, see what is an evidence-based practice, what is the best for our patient, what is best for our practice. So these are four things what we see in our research whenever we take any kind of research or any kind of clinical practice. So I'll be elaborating it here. So I already said, like, the first one is that. I think somebody is talking in between about Pongal. All right. So Belmont report. So autonomy, that is respect for person, non-maleficence. We should not do any harm to the participant or to any our patient. Beneficence, we have to see benefit, and justice should be there. So how we will take care of all these things, how the autonomy will be taken from a patient or from a participant. So I work in Annapurna University. We have 1,000 bedded hospital here. So whenever we go to our wards, we have different ward in charges from physical therapy, and we have one file protocol. So whoever comes from different departments, from pediatric medical department, or if the patient is referred from other department also, we have one kind of assessment sheet. In the assessment sheet itself, we have attached the informed consent. We do that for our physical therapy also. So once we go for a practice, we go and see patient, we explain everything to the patient, what exactly his or her problem is, what exactly we are going to do to him. We explain about the exercise protocol, what kind of exercise we are giving, and whether you will feel any discomfort, whether it's helpful or it's useful for you. Then we take an signature from the patient, then only we start a treatment in order to be at the safety side and in order to be at the great clinical practitioner, adhering all the rules and regulations of ethics. So same applies to an researcher also. When you are conducting any kind of research, so you have participants, your duty is to give an informed consent, which is again a big topic, like how we have to write an informed consent, what all should be written in informed consent, which I have not included here. That is a separate topic. So it is an willingness and agreement of a medical professional or a researcher or a clinician. Okay. So when you give a participant information sheet to the patient or to the participant, they should know what exactly you're doing. So if you have a patient from different languages, like the patient is not able to understand or speak English, so you can give them their own vernacular language. If you have a patient from Tamil Nadu, you can just give them the informed consent in Tamil. Or if you have from Karnataka, you can give in Kannada, based upon the language what patient understands. So what exactly is informed consent? There is no legal definition of informed consent, and it has come under section 13 of the Indian contract law, which is very important, which we are not adhering. So if leave about the hospital, if you are working in a hospital, we don't follow it. If anything claims, the court claims anything, if the patient claims anything and it goes to the court, university or hospital can save us. But when you are individually practicing somewhere, anything goes wrong under section 13 of the Indian contract law, you will be behind bars. Okay, if you don't take the consent or informed consent from the patient. So it's a permission. It is nothing like, it's not a scary document what you're taking from the participant or your patient. It is a permission, which is principle of respect for your autonomy. And it is a contract. It's not an obligation. So when a doctor is proposing it and the patient is deciding what he or she wants, so that is called as informed consent. There shouldn't be any force, there shouldn't be any pressure, there shouldn't be any lying, there shouldn't be any fraud. For example, patient comes to us and says that I want to go for this treatment. For example, again, I'll take osteoarthritis, or you will take an lumbar spondylosis or any kind of musculoskeletal disorder. So what we tell patient, you'll be perfectly fine after 7 days of physiotherapy treatment, I assure you, but it's wrong. We are not God. We don't have any kind of healing hand. We will just get rid them of the problem. We are just giving them the symptomatic relief, which every medical professional does. Even if they go to an orthopedician, they also can't just take away their difficulty or their illness. So we tell them and we force them. We tell them, okay, fine, this treatment, if you take, we will be perfectly fine. And sometimes we do fraud also. But if the patient comes, is very well educated, or the patient has been contacted to someone else, regarding this, so you will be behind bars. You will be behind jail. Your practice, your career, everything goes. In order to avoid all these things, when we are having an informed consent, whenever we are treating a patient, we can give the consent. We have clearly mentioned that so-and-so treatment will be given. So-and-so effect will be there. So the patient gives us a consent. Yes, I agree with your treatment, and this is an agreement between you and me. Sometimes, in case, if the patient complains about the section law 13 of Indian Code, so you have a documentation, you have an authentic documentation. This is a protocol given to the patient, and this is what we have done, and this is the signature of the patient. Okay, so what to inform? In a simple language, I will tell you like what we have to inform to the patient in an informed consent, how we have to write it. If you are a clinical practitioner, you can just make a small column down what all things we are supposed to write. What about the condition? Condition means when we write the diagnosis, osteoarthritis, write in their own language, which they understand. Procedure, what kind of procedure we are doing, what kind of protocol we are giving them. If it is an exercise, please mention that, what kind of exercise we are giving, what kind of modality we are using, what is the prognosis of this. If we see that we give a training to our students, when we take them for the bedside teaching or when they have case presentations, we allot them the cases. So we tell them after every 2 days, you have to do the reassessment. When they do the reassessment, they note down the prognosis. If this particular protocol is giving us a good prognosis, we continue with the same. If not, we discuss, we have clinical discussion. We'll see evidence-based practices and we change the protocol. So that has to be mentioned. Okay, this is the prognosis. You may feel better after 1 week. Your knee may be all right. You may be able to walk. Okay, this is how you are supposed to put. What are the benefits and significant risks? Benefits, your pain will be subsided. Your swelling may be subsided. Significant risks in the sense if there are any kind of risk. For example, you are giving a short, wax therapy for knee. Certain cases, the patient develops the redness around the knee joint or any joint, whichever you are treating, but you will not inform. The patient is getting very panic. Oh God, I got redness, and they go to door to door. Oh, I went to so-and-so clinic and they have done something wrong. But these things should be already informed to the patient. You should mention these are the significant risks and the patient should have signature. Orally, we tell them. Sometimes we teach our students, you are supposed to tell about this, but we don't document. Documentation is very important. Additional procedures, yes. If this procedure is not benefiting, we may go for additional procedures or any other treatment options if you have. Yes, if this is not treating, you may go to other clinic, or suppose, for example, a patient comes to us with cervical spondylosis, you may say, no, this is not. You can go for a neurological examination. This is cost. How much it will cost your treatment? What will be the duration of treatment? And if you are having a post-operative patient, what will be your management and what is your follow-up? That has to be written in their own language, which they understand. And it has to be signed by the patient or the patient party as per the law, as per the ethical considerations, to keep yourself safe, to keep your practice, clinical practice at, you know, high level. Already our physiotherapy has gone very down in India, but it's up to us how we lift it, how we perform it, how we practice it, how we address ourselves in front of other practitioners. Okay. So coming to the core of human values based on 4 ethical principles, which I already said, there is always a principle of essentiality. That is how we are going to deal with it, how we are going to have the confidentiality. Okay. How many of you have done that? Suppose we go and see, we have a patient and patient, you meet friend, you will say, oh, I was posted. For example, you are posted in Apollo Hospital for your internship. I'm just giving an example. You are posted in general medicine ward and you have given a patient, HIV positive patient. The patient is having some kind of breathlessness and you are advised to go for an breathing exercises. So you meet your friend, you will say, oh, I was there. I went and to see that HIV patient. I had to give breathing exercises. People around you are listening. So is this the ethical way you are doing your practice? No, it is completely wrong. You are not maintaining the dignity of the patient. You are not adhering the medical laws. You are not adhering the code of ethics in your practice. Okay, which is very, very important. Confidentiality, essentiality, it is very important. Whenever you go for clinical practice or research. Principles of voluntariness that already discussed: consent, informed consent, and the community agreement. Community agreement is something different when we go for in community-based researches. For example, if we are just going to any one particular community, we want to see an old age home. We want to take some population as geriatric population, and we want to check their balance. For example, I'm just giving you. So once you go there and check the balance, so you need to get the permission from the community. So there is a protocol how we have to follow the community. For example, we have a community health worker there who is heading the, we, that is called as gatekeeper. We have to get the permission from him. Then we have to get the permission from the head of the community center. Then we have to get the permission from the concerned participants. So if you're taking any kind of school community, I did my PhD studies in idiopathic scoliosis, which was done in among girls. So it was very difficult for me to obtain permission from schools. So my protocol was I had to go to the district wise. Mangalore, I did the study in Mangalore. So I had to segregate the divisions, north zone, south zone. Then I had to go to the individual block education officers, explain them, present my study, what exactly I'm doing along with the ethics, because they are very much particular about it. A lawyer was there. So I had to do a PPT presentation, like how I'm doing this research, what will be the benefit, how I'm
making it.
Can I request participants to mute their mics if they are not interested? Please mute your mics.
YouTube la unga name comment panniruka name mujja.
Can participant please mute the mic now, please?
Thank you. So we need to get the permission, so which is very important. Like then I had to get permission from the block education officers, give them the presentation, then go to the school authorities, talk to principals, give them presentation, then talk to girls as well as talk to parents, give them presentation what exactly I'm doing. So this is very important whenever you take any research. Suppose, for example, if a PhD candidate is there, anyone in this platform, so we do research and we just finish the research. Okay, fine, we'll just take the data from here and there without getting any permission and all those. Anyhow, our friends is helping, somebody is helping and do it. But once you go for publication in high index journal, they will ask you all these things. They will ask you your permission letter. You have you got your permission? Did you get the permission from so-and-so person? Do you have an ethical clearance? First of all, ethical clearance. To get an ethical clearance from the ethics committee is very difficult. They will check all these points. So before sending any research protocol to the research committee, we should know all these 12 principles, which in India, ICMR guidelines are giving every year. They are revising the principles, which is very important to day-to-day research we are conducting. Privacy and confidentiality, which is very important. And professional competence, we have to see the risk minimization. There shouldn't be risk. We can't say that any research, there is no risk. Yeah, there are, whatever, if it is a simple research, if we're giving a questionnaire study also to our participant, it has a risk. It has a minimal risk. So we should always mention in the informed consent, yes, there is minimal risk. Otherwise, if you just say, right, no, there is no risk, you will get back. You will be questioned by the ethics committee saying that there is no study which has got no harm or no risk. So accountability and transparency should be there, and there should be distributive justice, and there should be institutional arrangements. Like if you're conducting any kind of study in your institution, you should have all kind of facilities there in your institution, which is again a question, ethical approval will not be given to you for your study. So these are certain points which we have to consider taking research. Now, coming to patient care, when we are doing patient care, how we are increasing the issues for healthcare. So if you see that we are encountering ourselves, the many conflicting values, beliefs, goals, responsibility. We are not concerned about person's right, fairness, justice, and all those things. You know, when the patient comes to us and we be very rude, we tell them, be that side, we don't just value the person, which is very important in ethics. Like, respect human values. Human values, if you are respecting in your clinical practice, I'm just clubbing both research and clinical practice because the topic is clubbed together. So if you are taking, you have to value the human respect, human dignity, which is very, very important in your clinical practice, which makes you a good practitioner or a good researcher. So what are the ethical dilemmas we face in our clinical practice? So first thing is, we have to breach of confidentiality. So whenever we are treating patients, so we have an open hall, we don't maintain the confidentiality. We will put one patient in one bed, other patient in one bed, and we are putting patient in the shortwave and other patient in the traction. We'll be switching ourselves here and there. We don't maintain the confidentiality. Sometimes if any inspection, ethics committee, law, anyone comes into the existence, they give a spot inspection to your clinic, you will be, you know, in trouble. So here it is, I've just given an example of dental here because recently I took this for dentals to faculty. So it was like failure to disclose the mistakes, what we have done. For example, if we just take an example of dentist only, if dentist has done any mistake, so they will not admit it. If the patient goes, they will say, no, it is not. You, maybe your tooth was, you have not taken medication properly. So they have not, you know, that suppose RTC, root canal is done. They'll say, no, actually it was done this side. We have done in a proper way. So it is like they will hide their mistake. It's always good. If you have done any kind of mistake, please admit it and rectify it. Over-treatment and poor quality of treatment, any kind of poor quality of treatment and over-treatment, which is also an ethical dilemma or ethical challenge we face in clinical practice. Request for fraudulent documents. Okay, when you have a proper documentation, you fare for nothing. Any law comes, any ethics comes, we don't. But if we are having any kind of fraud documentation, we will be always in trouble. And in any kind of inappropriate treatment, or if we are not having informed consent, or if we are doing any kind of unethical behavior along with the clinicians. So human values and patient care, which is very, very important. So we should always have a relationship that is doctor-patient relationship, which is very important for our clinical practice, which is very important for our career as well. So when you take care of your patient as your first concern, you should treat patient very politely and considerably, but we should not make friendship with patient. That is also an ethical point. Recently, many cases have come into existence where the patient and doctor had developed a very good relationship. Like, they were overnight chatting with each other. They used to call, they used to go for a coffee. But certain many things arises, ethical issues arise because of that, and the doctors were behind bars. So we should have a value that is called as patient-doctor relationship. We should maintain to such an extent where we should not exceed our limits. We should maintain the dignity and privacy. We should give the complete information to the patient about the condition, what he or she is suffering, which he understands, okay? And the patient has got full rights to decide. It is not like we are forcing them, and we should have a professional knowledge and skills. If we see in our profession itself, we have different kind of expertise. Like, some are expertise in pediatrics, some are in cardio, some are in neuro, some are in musculoskeletal. But how many of you treat patient as per your expertise? No one. If you are having a clinic, you are MPT pediatrics, you are treating patients, those who come with osteoarthritis, adult cases. Do we do justice? No, we don't do justice to our profession. We don't do justice to our skills. And we should always recognize the limits of our professional competence. So whenever we go, suppose, for example, my friend is having clinic next side. So she is musculoskeletal physical therapist and pediatric physical therapist. The patient comes to me, an old lady comes, around 50-year-old female comes and tells that, I went to that clinic, I did not get any relief. Please treat me. What I will say? I'll say, oh, that therapist is very bad. She doesn't have good knowledge and she doesn't have equipments. I'll treat you. come, please, you will get treatment done. Do we do that? We do that. Not only physical therapy, many medical fraternity people are doing that, but that is wrong. That is, we are limiting, we are going for the professional competence. Friends, to be honest, I'll tell you one thing. If you adhere the rules and regulations of ethics in your research or in your practice, you will feel proud of yourself. You will feel complete. You will get mental stability and the mental kind of, you know, freeness. Yes, you are doing something justice to you and justice to your job. Coming to the point where this is not applicable to us, our fraternity, but still I'll take it. This is about the breaking news to terminally ill patients. When the patient is having any kind of disease, for example, if you take a carcinoma, the doctor hides news, which is very bad. So I will share one example. It's a very touching, actually. We have one center here in Mangalore, which is a palliative care center. And there we have all cancer patients. We do visit there. We take our students there for a visit, and we also visit there sometimes. So one day I saw a lady there. She was crying very badly, very badly. She was crying. She was around 43 years of age. So I asked sister, why is she crying? She said, ma'am, she's having carcinoma, but it was not told to her. She have no one. She is only one all alone. So she's a teacher, actually. So one of her relative have sent her to the palliative care saying that you'll be taken care there nicely. So whenever we give any kind of palliative program to other patients, she will not come. She'll say, I don't have anything. I'm not here for palliative care. I have just come here for, you know, for a care. It is like a tour to me. It's like a vacation to me. But now she is living hardly for 1 week, not more than 1 week. She got this news and she's crying very badly. Then I had no, you know, courage to go to that lady. I was really stunned. I had no courage. Then I checked her file. She had carcinoma uterus and it has gone to malignant phases. It has gone to lungs also. Then finally, the administrator, I went and spoke to her. I told her, like, I have come here as a faculty from physiotherapy, but I am also a part of ethics. I want to know what exactly has happened with this lady. Then she told me it is like she is a teacher and she came to know about her disease now. And she's crying. The first moment what she did is she picked the call and she called doctor and she scolded doctor very badly, saying that, how could you do this to me? I have no one. I have my property. I have few hours or few days left. How could I do justice to that? And she was completely broken. Then I told her, that is wrong. This is ethically wrong, what you have done, what the doctor has done. But later on, that doctor was, you know, questioned and so many ethical issues happened. And finally, after 2 days, that lady expired. So these are very important issues where, you know, sometimes our patient's relative only say, please don't disclose this news. Otherwise, if the patient comes to know, he may die with a heart attack, or he may be depressed, or he may commit suicide, and we be quiet. But that is wrong. If anything goes wrong, we will be blamed. So it is very important, like physicians or anybody who should have, suppose we work in palliative care as a physical therapist, or we work in onco wards, it's our responsibility to have a professional obligation to disclose important information to the patients. And it is like, whatever is that, we should have an honest communication, there should be transparency, and it should be one center, like one size, it should fill all the documents. We should know what is exactly the documentation by the other departments, the same thing we have to convey to them. And next one is the respect and the dignity, which is again one ethical issue we are facing in our clinical practice, is stigma, discrimination, privacy, confidentiality. As I already mentioned earlier, like HIV, we have HIV positive, we will just spread it like anything. We'll say, oh, I'm treating that HIV. Oh, please don't go there. No, why? Why you are just having the discrimination of that patient? If the patient is leprosy, I think when I was doing my UG from Chennai, we had one leprosy center. We used to go there. I don't remember the name of that place. They were all leprosy patients, and we used to get very scared, and our teachers also used to be very, you know, like behind, and those people were feeling very discriminated. It was a stigma. We are health professionals. We should follow the rules and regulations, how we have to protect ourselves, but we don't have any rights to, you know, discriminate somebody based on their respect or based on the dignity. And sometimes the privacy and confidentiality. And if any patient comes and tells us, I have this problem, next day, a patient's party comes and we will just disclose that. These are certain medical issues or ethical challenges we face in our day-to-day life in practices. Maybe, you know, it may be simple, but it is very, very complicated one once any law or ethics come into practice. So if we see the stigma and discrimination, I have given one example. Even if we just take, leave about the medical practice, leave about the research, if we just take our day-to-day life, our children. So if our child is eating very slowly, how will we discriminate and, you know, humiliate child? We'll say, oh, you're so slow. You are like a snail. Okay, yuck, please don't do that. Don't talk like that. So these are all the discrimination and stigma which we follow in our day-to-day life as well, not only the practice. Are my slides visible?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
All right.
Yes,
ma'am. So discrimination in the hospitals. If any patient is having any kind of safety or care, we don't follow the rules. We don't get the feedback. For example, if we are just having, this is mouth. This I have taken from an oral patient, oral cancer, because I have expertise in oral cancer also. I do oral rehabilitation in oral cancer. I have written my own book also in oral cancer chapter along with our vice chancellor, who is oncosurgeon. And currently I have written a manual for head and neck cancer patients rehabilitation program. So this picture is taken like how we give the protocol. So when we see the oral submucous fibrosis, which we call as precancerous condition in oral cancer. So we have a physiotherapy protocol because those patients feel trismus, they feel, the inability to open their mouth, and they feel that weakness in the muscles. So I give them certain kind of protocol. So how we are treating those patients? When we see, so we feel, when we are wearing the gloves, we have some kind of grinning face, we have some kind of, you know, different face, and we try to keep them on isolation wards. We will discuss with the co-workers, oh, that patient, oh, he has got oral cancer, oh, she has got like that, plastic gloves we wear during examination. These are not the values, because it's not the disease which is going to harm us. No, it is not something like corona, like we are touching patient and we'll get it. No, it is something like which we are treating the patient or examining the patient. We are not getting any harm, but by acting so and so, we are, you know, giving some kind of disgrace to the human value, to the humanity, to the patient. So all these things, how we take care? We should take the consent. Who all are able to take the consent? The nurse is able to take the consent, healthcare professional, PG, intern, these are the label persons who can take consent. Not your attender can take a consent. Suppose you have any patient working in your, cleaner or your attender or your akka, you give the form and tell her, akka, please, you tell this patient to fill it. But no, your signature should be there. So when the akka gives a signature and she may take a wrong information or he may take a wrong information, so where ethics comes into existence, you'll be in trouble. So you have the expertise you can take, or if you have an intern, you have PG, you have nurse, or you have any healthcare professional, those can take the consent based upon the four principles, Belmont report, that is autonomy, that is informed consent, how we take, that is separate one. If time permits, I would love to take that informed consent part also. Then we have how we are maintaining the confidentiality, what are the reports we are supposed to write, and what will be the documentation of all these things. So this was about this. And now care ethics, it is one, two slides I have mentioned. It is not part of ethical challenges in research, but care ethics, which is lining up with the ethical challenges we face in clinical practice. How many of you have seen this lady? Any idea about this lady? You all are there with me?
No, ma'am. We didn't see.
Huma Maheshwari. You have not seen this lady? Who is Aruna? Aruna Shanbhag. Oh, it's really surprising. Fine. This is Aruna Shanbhag, who was a nurse, who was raped by an attender, and she was in a hospital for 40 years in coma when she died, and she was given dignity death. That is called as euthanasia. Have you heard about that? No. Okay. So care ethics, again, when we are giving any kind of treatment to the patient, we are maintaining the confidentiality, we are maintaining the privacy, we are giving the appropriate treatment, we are following the Belmont report. But what is care ethics? Care is not something like we have to care for a patient, feed patient, dress a patient. No, that is completely different. Under care ethics, we have doctor-patient relationship, which I already discussed earlier. And the second thing is death with dignity. So that there are certain cases where the patient is declared for death with dignity, that is called as euthanasia, based upon the willingness of the patient, or based upon the willingness of the attendant, or based upon the willingness of the family members. So euthanasia is something about the dignified death. So same thing happened with this lady. She was working, it's in India actually, she was working in Delhi hospital, and she was raped by an attendant. And then she got a coma under 40 years. She was under coma in a hospital. Her sister and not sister, actually, she was a nurse. She was her friend. She was taking care of her for 40 years. 40 years, nothing happened with her. She was not progressing. She was deteriorating. And finally, the government gave the rules. Ethics came into existence saying that she should be given a dignified death. That is euthanasia. They will kill her. That is called as euthanasia, but it is a dignified death. Killing in the sense, not strangling her or anything. There are different types of euthanasia, again, which is a different topic. So I don't want to touch it here. So that is different. That is active euthanasia, passive euthanasia, how we give the dignified death to the patient. So again, here, if you see that another picture, this was right to live versus right to die. If the patient has got right to live, they have got full rights to die also. Suppose, for example, caregivers have a burden. They have burden. They have financial difficulties, and the patient is deteriorating, not progressing. So euthanasia says that the patient has got full rights to end his or life. So this can be done by different modes, like we give some injectables, and we can take out the, if the patient is on ventilator, we wean off the ventilator. These kind of procedures we will follow. That's a different one, so I'm not touching it here. So actually, euthanasia, this was a medical contest which came in by Francis Bacon in 17th century, where they said that physician's responsibility to elevate physical sufferings of the body. So as a physician, as a practitioner, or as a clinician, we have full responsibility to elevate the sufferings of any physical body. But same time, if the patient is suffering, euthanasia can be the best option. But in India, it was not legalized. As the Shanbhag's case came, then only it was legalized in India. Only that when the patient is in coma status, then only the patient can go for a euthanasia, that is dignified death. Okay. Now, coming to the integrity, can I have some few more minutes? Madam Jensi is there? Yes, someone was there. Yes, please.
Rashid?
Yes, ma'am. Can I continue or you want me to stop?
Can you able to hear my voice?
Yes, I can. So I have a few more slides. You want me to continue or you want me to stop?
No, ma'am. No, pa. Your wish.
Okay, fine. Thank you.
Okay, ma'am. Okay. Thank you.
So coming to the integrity, what is integrity? It is coming like keeping integrity and your work ethics in contact or in touch or intact. It is done by, said by Kathy Erland. So it is something like a doctor trust patient and patient trust doctor, which causes again the patient relationship, doctor-patient relationship, which I already told you, handling complications, medical error reporting, and medical negligence. These are the two basic components what we are facing in our clinical practice, that is medical error reporting and medical negligence. Now you'll be telling me what exactly is medical error reporting or medical negligence. So when we are talking about the relationship, doctor-patient relationship, we already discussed earlier, there should be good communication, there should be empathy, there should be trust, we should have an informed consent, and we should have professional bodies in our treatment protocol, whichever we are following. Medical negligence, something like, I will just talk about a fact saying that mother of seven sterilized at government hospital got certificate, operation was successful. After operation, she conceived and gave birth to a girl. Evidence established only RT fallopian tube has been operated. So will you call it as medical negligence? Yes. What is medical negligence? It is something like what we do mistake from the medical side. If a person, a lady, she doesn't want any child, she has been done sterilization, but after some months, she's getting a report that she's conceived and she's giving birth to a baby girl. And when they recheck it, they find that only her right tube, fallopian tube, was operated. Left was kept like that only, because of that, she got pregnant. So what the doctor can say, what the law says, doctor who had performed the operation has acted in the most neglect manner, and further, the state was vigorously labeled for the doctor's negligence. And this doctor was put in jail. Similarly, if we say in our practice, for example, we are treating a joint. So we are, the patient gives us a history stating that she's got diabetes, she's got hypertension, she's very, severely diabetic, and she is on injectables and she's got some kind of mental disturbance also, but still we treat her. We treat her knee joint, and maybe she gets some kind of complications. That is purely a medical negligence. Why? Because we know her history. We got to know about her history, but still we treated her. We neglected her. So if any law comes into existence or any clinic ethics comes into existence, that will be a problem for us. So example, the next one will say that Poonam Verma versus Ashwin Patel. It was like fact. Doctors registered as homeopath. They treated patient for 8 days, administered strong antibiotics initially for the treatment of viral fever and later typhoid fever without confirming diagnosis. So later what happens when they prescribe the IM injection, that is intramuscular injection to relieve pain, something happened very uncertain. What happens is the court found the doctors guilty and they were confirming that Miss practice, that is medical negligence, which we do in our practice, which our students are doing it. So whenever students, we are giving them the cases or they are treating any patient, or if you see in our clinical practice also, we get any case, we'll say, okay, fine, we'll do kind of examination, we'll check range of motion, we'll check, ask some history, then we'll start treatment without confirming the diagnosis, which may backfire us. So same thing happens with Poonam Verma, who treated a patient with Ashwin Patel. Actually, she was an homeopathy doctor. She gave medicine for viral fever. Then later on, she gave for typhoid fever. Finally, the patient complained very uncertain condition. And this doctor was behind bars for misdiagnosis. This is the pure medical negligence. What we have, an ethical dilemma we face in our clinical practices. Medical error reporting. Initially, it was medical negligence. Now, medical error reporting. What is medical error reporting? Medical error reporting is something where the healthcare providers are committing some kind of mistake. Then they will not put it in the document and they try to hide it, which causes harm to the patient and which can be very, brutal or lethal or anything. And we are not supposed to apologize for that. We are not saying that we are apologizing the patient, but the medical documentation should be proper. If you're working in some multi bedded hospital, multi-center, multi-specialty hospital, you're working as a physical therapist, your role is to maintain the medical report. So whenever you are treating a patient, you should give the correct, exact information. If you commit mistake, please rectify it then and there. That is, again, a medical error reporting, which is applicable for research also. Medical negligence is not applicable for research, but medical error reporting is essential for research. When you take a research, collect the data, sometimes if here and there, suppose you are taking a BMI of a candidate or you're taking a range of motion, then you are checking for the spinal deformity using any kind of, for example, you are using a plumb line or you're using Adam forward bending test. The readings you are mismatching here, which gives the wrong statistical analysis. When you are giving the wrong statistical analysis, the result itself is changing. Your aim of the study or your research question itself is changing. So this is very important in both cases, medical error reporting, which we need to consider. Okay. Integrity, again, the communication with the patient. This, I'm just sharing one case. It's a true case. And the case was raised in Children's Medical Center of Tehran University, Iran. So there was a 12-day-old newborn infant and who was hospitalized in a neonatal intensive care unit because of multiple fits. Fits were controlled by medications and diagnostic assessments, including electroencephalography and EEG was ordered. As the infant was stable and had tolerated breastfeeding, it was planned to transfer him to the level 2 NICU, but it was postponed due to lack of available beds. Beds were not available in the NICU 2. On the evening shift of the third day of the admission, his nurse heard a sudden noise and noticed that the incubator door was open and the baby was on the floor. The in-charge nurse immediately announced the incident to the on-call physician. The newborn was examined thoroughly and no physical injuries were found. Moreover, the incident was reported to the chief physician of the department and the record of this incident was immediately sent to the hospital officials. Later, all the incubators were inspected to make sure they were secure enough. Can you please tell me whose fault is this? What are the ethical issues are here in this case? Please be open to discussion, no matter. You tell me wrong also, no issues. Okay, tell me please. You all are there with me? Okay, fine. So here we cannot blame anyone, but here we can say that this was purely an hospital mismanagement because there was no room available, no bed available in the NICU 2 where patient has to be, transferred. But same case when we say that sister nurse who is completely responsible, she was responsible for the, NICU unit where she should have seen that the baby is in good position. But in this, I think here I have not continued this slide. Then later on what happened in this story. It's a real story. I have taken this from a case study from Tehran University. So the father of a child, he blamed mother and he was, given punishment for that, stating that it is your fault, but it was not her fault actually. So the second story, if we say one of the cases that gives rise to ethical concern is a 50-year-old male patient was brought to emergency room and had severe chest pain and shortness of breath. After all necessary investigations, he was diagnosed of myocardial infarction and was decided for surgery. Family was consented, his coronary artery bypass grafting was done, and the patient was brought to CICU in critical condition. He was weaning off from ventilator for 3 days and he was successfully extubated. Soon after his extubation, he developed breathing difficulty and was going to respiratory failure. So he was planning to elective re-intubation. That time, 1 year junior resident from anesthesia performed traumatic intubation and injured the patient's vocal cords badly. These days after this event, when the doctor was not able to extubate the patient successfully, they realized the patient has got vocal cord paralysis because of the traumatic intubation. Due to vocal cord paralysis, this patient needed lifetime tube in the trachea for survival. So his family was told about tracheostomy of the patient. The patient developed pneumonia and multiple other infections due to prolonged intubation and tracheostomy. Again, here we can see many ethical issues. The junior doctor, where we said that there was no expertise, there was no supervision from the senior doctor. So this patient was in trouble, and this patient was, intubated in such a way where they damaged his vocal cords and he went for paralysis for lifetime. And later on, he developed pneumonia and multiple other infections. But the patient party were told different things. They were told, no, it was done for tracheostomy and all those things. So these are certain ethical issues what we face. We always have to value an enduring belief, a specific mode of conduct or end state of existence with a relative importance. So no matter the patient is, if you see me, I had conducted this study, the social and ethical issues, what a cancer patient feels. So this was my research, what I have done, and it got published in PubMed and Scopus Journal also. It got accepted, so it is under publication. So here it was a very important thing, like where we maintain the confidentiality, where we follow the rules, ethical rules in conducting research, all Belmont report, whatever we have discussed from past 1 hour. So which is very important for both cases where you are a researcher or a clinician. Actually, there is a lot to discuss ethics. It's a very vast and very beautiful field, but I could just concise it in a very small presentation. If time permits, I would love to do that, because my aim is to spread the ethical values, ethical consideration in our physiotherapy fraternity. So please be safe in your research, in your clinical practice, wherever you go. Practice confidently, practice with ethical values, code of ethics, which is very important for each and every healthcare professional. So any questions? Thank you for listening to me, and thank you so much, Madam Jensi and Madam Selvarani, for giving me this opportunity. If any questions, I would be happy to answer you all.
Thank you, Mudashir. Once again, thank you for your valuable session for a long time.
Thank you.
With the examples, it is very useful. Students, any questions? PG students? Internee students, any questions?
No, ma'am.
Okay, if there are no questions, ma'am, you have any questions? You can please go ahead. If any faculty has got any questions, please go ahead.
Ma'am, your presentation was so nice.
Thank you.
It was more related with the legal issues.
Mm-hmm.
I think our students, it is very new, not very new, little bit it is very new for legal issues.
Mm-hmm.
So it will take some time. They have to understand and they to ask questions.
Yes.
That is the reason, I think so.
Mm-hmm. Yes, that's true.
Yeah, your presentation is very nice.
It was,
and with the examples.
Yeah, thank you. It's a new subject to us, actually. So it is very interesting, and we all should know actually about
it. Definitely all the physiotherapists should know.
I presented this same topic in IAP conference 2020, where
okay.
It was like well appreciated, and I think we have this, if you see the picture here, we have
yeah.
Ethics Center. We train there all the fraternity, not only
okay.
People. We train all fraternity there. And this is our director, Dr. Veena Vaswani. She is actually from forensic medicine, professor forensic
yes.
medicine, and she has done PhD in, ethics.
Can you tell me a little bit about the medical ethics course and where you can join once they have finished?
They can actually, after completion of graduation, they can join this course. It's a postgraduate
okay.
diploma, 1 year.
Okay.
So it is in collaboration with the Gothenburg University, Germany. So
okay.
We get a certificate. We have a research project to do for this 1 year. We have internal exams and we have one final exam also, university exam.
Okay.
And once you are awarded with this degree, you can, just... take any ethics classes, or you can be any ethics faculty, or you can be a part of ethics committee. And if you are sound enough in ethics, the roles and responsibilities will be given to you. As I said, like we go for site inspections, whether any ethical issues are happening in research and other things. So this
is we have more opportunities when we finish this, no?
Yes.
In abroad.
Yes, we have good opportunities actually, because this is completely in India, like we don't have much knowledge about this.
Ethics.
So once you do it, so you have, it's like something like added flavor to your food, right? So when you show your CV and then you say that I have this kind of degree, they really appreciate you. And recently I got an offer to Turkey. It was an international university. They hired me not based on my PhD. They hired me based on my ethics. But unfortunately, I could not join them because I had other commitments with the university. So I could not. So it has got a very good, and it is, as long as you are a researcher, you are a clinician, it is very good to know about it. And it is conducted yearly once. Jan starts the course, Jan or Feb. So it has got 3 modules actually. So we conduct in 3 modules, and we have a research project in this.
Okay. Rashid, once again, thank you for your explanation and the valuable ideas regarding medical legal ethics, especially after physiotherapy, whether it is useful or not. So the students,
it is very important, no, ma'am, for us. Yes. Like when we enter into physiotherapy, we have a different image. So once the student reaches to first year, second year, they think like we are massagers. Yes. We do massage, we are technicians, but we are not seeing our field in a very different way. We have got a very beautiful field. The way we take it, the way we, you know, practice it, it's all up to us. So
this is
very important. Like we have to be shoulder to shoulder with all the practitioners.
Yeah, definitely.
So that is how we have to improve our career and improve our profession.
Yes, definitely.
So I wish all of us can do well, and all of us, I wish all the best to everyone. And thank you, students, for joining me. Thanks a lot for being so patient with me.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
So say, at least you please inform whether you can able to understand about the medical legal ethics.
Yes, ma'am.
Please
inform. Hello, ma'am. It's very useful, ma'am.
Yeah.
And now we are doing MPT first year, ma'am, in our college. We are having research methodology, ma'am.
Okay.
So by knowing that research ethics, it's very, very useful for us, ma'am.
Okay.
Thank you very much, ma'am.
Okay. Mudashir?
Yes. Thank you so much. Thanks a lot.
Okay. Mudashir.
Yeah. So
once again, thank you, Mudashir, for your valuable presentation and ideas, information. Okay. What you have given. Any students, any questions?
No, ma'am. Thank you. Thank you very much. For valuable. Okay,
Mudashir. Thank you once again. On behalf of the Cheran Institute of Health Sciences and Cheran College of Physiotherapy, on behalf of our principal, ma'am, and our staff and students, once again, I want to convey our thanks to you for your valuable presentations. Okay.
Thank you so much, ma'am. Thank you. Have a good day to you all. Thank you. All the best, students. Bye. Thank you.
We'll meet once again, please. Thank you.